I came at the seams upon the instruments of death, the sunlight brightly gleams when every man is torn with nightmares and with dreams. Will no one lay the laurel wreath when silence drowns the scream?
Okay, we're back. Hardcore Productions, Blooper Oracle, back with an awesome, we're going to have an awesome time tonight. Back with this great segment. I have Tala from Australia. She's come on with me, and she's doing a lot of work out there in Australia, and just got back from New Zealand on a trip to clear some. From what I'm listening to, you clear out a lot of stuff, and so we're all going through the process, and as mages and as path workers, and bringing things into a place where they're coming, where our lives are coming into alignment. And to do that, it takes work, it takes choices to principle and cosmic principle, and to keep yourself in a space of sovereignty, free will, and sacred space within your own mindset. And this takes a lot of work, it takes a lot of time, it takes a lot of energy, and it takes a lot of purging things out so you can create the awareness to choice. And shedding the ignorance, which is basically your karmic aspect, and then purging the evil within that's been placed within the implants of our fucking etheric bodies, and this is what we're dealing with, and that's why we're here, and that's why we've come in this incarnation, and we've decided to, hey, we're gonna step up to the plate here now, we're gonna take this challenge, and we didn't come here to fucking lose, did we?
No, definitely not. Yeah, it's great to be on, Rodney, and to chat with you about this tonight. And I just watched your video on Jera today, and just how that cyclic kind of thing is kicking in with this Pluto transit that we're about to experience, coming out of the Saturn into Aquarius. And also the runes before Jera, we've got Haglas, Nathuas, and Issa. So we've kind of had those retrogrades that have been like that, pull back that kind of the Issa, the stagnation, the disaster of Haglas, all that has kind of gone down, but it's how we've navigated that to get to now Jera. Absolutely. And what's happening with this new cycle of 2023. Absolutely. So it's an important time to chat.
So yeah, so Haglas played a huge role in context to the hammer, hammering the over. Hammering, causing these disruptions, the tower, the lightning strike, the Haggalah, and the hammers coming down on us, because that's what we've decided to do. We've decided to allow that work of Haggalahs within us to do its thing, and then
that's what forges us.
Yeah. And then breaking through the ice, of Issa, and creating the heat. And then releasing that heat so that the water element thing could then flow within us.
Mm-hmm. Mm. And another thing I thought about Jera is it's Kenaz, but reflected on itself. And Kenaz is the ignition. It's the fire, it's that soul spark kind of central core, ignition that we're now tapping into through that cycle. We've done that. If you've done that work, we're reaping what we sow in terms of these things. And yeah, that can also be a polarity because you've got the two reflecting on themselves. So there's all different aspects coming in for us. But I'm certainly noticing it.
Exactly. I kind of covered that in the video about, what the torch is. And, when you think about it, Kenaz is that chore. It's the torch, but what's on the torch? What's driving the energy of the torch? Your pain. See, it's been the pain. It's been, facing it, facing the mirror, the wounds, that have been bloodied with the rags that you've wrapped the wounds in to heal. And then you take all those bloody rags after you've been healed and you've healed that area of your life, right? You wrap them around that torch and that becomes kenos, because you now have the understanding and experience of going through the fire, going through, you know, breaking through the, you know, the veil, piercing the veil, you know, and then kenos becomes that light, that lighthouse, your intuition, you know, becomes your power base in context to being able to see, to navigate. And that's creating awareness, right? I mean, that's what we're talking about here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And that passion as well, to actually want to move forward and to keep doing that work, to keep that momentum with each day, to stay in that flow, because we don't want to go back to ISA, which is that stagnation. We've got to forge through and
keep
that momentum happening. Yeah,
ISA is necessary, you know, because ISA can also act as a mirror as well, you know, in the reflection of the ISA itself.
Yeah.
You know, so it does give us a chance to actually look at the reflection of who we are and the version of ourselves that we're dealing with. And this is shamanic work. It's deep shamanic work that we're doing, and it's not easy. But this is why we're doing it, right? I mean, the whole purpose is to create what our original timeline by our choices that we're making, that we're putting into the ethers. And that is, you know, the harvest, you know? And so that's Jera also, you know, in context, if you really want to think about it, you know, to the actual timeline that we're creating, and then being able to reap a harvest of that and see that come into manifestation in the reality field. So that is a harvest.
Yeah. It's also the 12th rune. So it's that whole yearly cycle coming into the 13th afterwards, which is Ewes, never pronounced that one right, Ewes, which is like the spindle, isn't it, of the Yggdrasil, the U, which is that kind of immortality. So, I've been looking at the runes as well and just seeing these progressions of how they fit together and how they intertwine. And it's kind of like looking at a physiological system or something of the human body, but the structure of the universe are the runes, you know, how they interconnect to make these systems that function together, but they've also got their own kind of symbiotic kind of thing going on and their own symbol and meaning. So it's a lifelong practice looking at it. It's so deep.
It's lifelong, and and that's the thing, is that people are ignorant of actually what's working within them. And so that ignorance then merkstaves the runes, because that's the power of them, you know? Instead of being upright, they're merkstave. And so that creates the lesson, right? It creates the, you know, the force of what you're going to have to go through to, you know, flip the magnet on the rune. And I think that's really the challenge. And, you know, all these arts of gnosis work together, the runes, astropsychology, you know, even getting into the Ogham script and
the tarot,
all these numerology, all these different arts of gnosis that are just weaving and working together, you really do set a beautiful tapestry of who you are. You know, it kind of fits
the
mold, you know, so you can really kind of see and look and understand and become responsible for who you are as well, taking on that responsibility and that accountability of who you truly are as a universal sovereign being, you know, you can call it the sons of God, I guess, S-U-N, you know, because, you know, we are that in context. And so, you know, we are birthed here to, you know, work with, you know, all of these arts of gnosis, all of these energies, all this 3D, you know, physical manifested world, and learn how to master it, you know. And that's what people forget when they're doing. We're really here to master the realm, right? And that's where the runes come in. Then once we begin to take a practice and understand them, right, the runes come in to help us to come into that mastery, the 0 to 9 path, you know, the Odin path, you know, all these different paths that you can take and study and archetypes that bring us into a place where then we begin to understand that within ourselves.
Mm. Going back to knowing ourselves, isn't it? It's that self-study. In the Sanskrit, they call it swadhyaya, which is, self-introspection. It's one of the niyamas, which is the personal kind of work we need to do, certain austerities and measures and practices we need to take to actually learn to know thyself. And that's an infinite process. and looking at these archetypes and connecting with that sun, soul spark, you know, we can get more kind of light on who we really are. And with that kind of solidify our soul and our spirit here in this world and what we're here to do, you know, actually start to, you know, actualize that. You mentioned before about tapping into the potential that we have that is there dormant within us, you know, and, you know, once again, coming to the soul spark, the sun, you know, and that eclipse that can occur, you know, where things can be shrouded or hidden or suppressed due to, you know, the overlay that we spoke about, you know, these different systems that have kind of shrouded that net that's over the collective consciousness and the planet, and maybe even this whole entire of Midgard, you know, which is, you know, looking at the whole universe or, you know, solar system or whatever, you know, we've got this overlay happening. But through this process of knowing ourselves and shedding this light, we can kind of burn things up and disentangle from that overlay and know what's ours and what's not, and start to discern a little bit clearer. Because, when you don't know yourself, you're more open to manipulation because you don't know who you are. So these things can start, you know, hooking in and manipulating your thought processes and your actions. And because you don't have that self-introspection, you just go along with it. And that's that ignorance, you know, avidya in Sanskrit, it's ignorance, you know.
Right.
But really just wanting to burn through that shit, hey?
Yeah, that's
the mission, yeah?
It masks itself as you. That's the thing. Mm-hmm. See?
Exactly, yeah.
I think it's you, but it's really not you. That's how it masks itself, see?
Mm-hmm.
So until you start to know who you are and realize that's not you, that's not who you are, you know, then you can start to process and integrate that energy. So really what they're doing is they're giving you energy, but they've inverted the energy so that you can run on your, you know, run on reverse, you know, your system on reverse, so that, you know, it's being siphoned off instead of being connected to source. So they run it in reverse. Mm-hmm. Pull on from the shadow aspect, but they have to give energy to do that. And as a mage, once you create awareness, right, then you're able to take that energy and transmute it into power, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what runes help you do.
Flip that inversion.
Because then they're helping you get into your untapped potential that's been overlaid, you know, in context to what? The miasma, the fog, the dream, not being able to see shit. You know, navigating, bumping into rocks with your boat, you know, and the whole idea behind it is that to keep you not being able to navigate to your North Star, you know, so you've got no momentum, you've got nothing to you know, propel you into a place where you're navigating correctly. And so all the distractions, all the bullshit that goes on, you know, it's just one meme after another. On Facebook, I just look at it. I'm just going, holy shit! It just blows my mind. You know, I mean,
but the synchronicity that comes from those memes too is quite incredible. And can I share a story about what happened to me last week with this?
Yeah.
So coming back to what we're talking about, and in terms of the, you know, the overlay and you know, the whole Lovecraft mythos, we've got Cthulhu, or the old ones, which has come up a lot recently, you know, with this whole needlecraft thing. And there was the other morning I was watching the video that Veritas did with the guy cracking the shits because it was getting exposed with the needlecraft. And I watched that in the morning, and then later on I saw Thomas Sheridan talk about Cthulhu and how it was there was a picture of the Cthulhu octopus in the background of that, the Pfizer guy's video, right? There's a meme going around and it's got the octopus in the background. And yeah, I was like, okay, that's interesting. And then later that day, I was at a wake, at my auntie's wake, actually, and a guy randomly picks up his phone, someone that's got no idea about any of this stuff, and he shows me this meme, and it's a picture of Cthulhu, and it says, "No lives matter." And I'm just like, whoa, okay. So it was quite bizarre that just one thing after the other, it's been brought to light, you know, it's pretty dark topic, but the way it was kind of brought to light in my life in that moment, in that day, you know, it's burning it up, it's shedding light. And then a few days later, a friend's telling me about a dream she had just off the bat. I didn't tell her about any of this. And she's telling me she had this dream where she was floating up, like ascending up into space, and all these people were doing it and they had balloons and they were floating up. And she looked down and she saw a sea full of blood. And had that viscosity of blood, and out came this octopus-like being, and it started grabbing people who were ascending and pulling them down into the blood. And my jaw dropped because I just had this whole synchronicity around this topic, and then she's confirming it even further with this prophetic dream she's had. So, yeah, it's just incredible how these things, when you come on path with the higher force, you know, even though that's quite a dark topic there, it was shedding light on it. It was showing me how things have kind of occurred on that metaphysical level, that, you know, symbolic kind of level of things, and how the more we shed light on it, the more we can transmute, and we can allow ourselves to not be under the influence of these type of things, you know?
Yeah.
So, yeah. Crazy.
Talking about that dream, you know, I was just seeing the needlecraft, you know, the act. Physical aspect of what they, from the etheric, what they actually physically have put into the bodies of many people now who may have been scheduled for ascension. You know, they may have come in here to be, to do that, but now this is another block. It's something that's, you know, they've taken, you know, whatever, and now they're they're not in a good position, you know.
No.
And
it's this Hydra parasite that they're finding within it, you know, which goes back to Cthulhu again. And, you know, the Hydra in the Greek mythology, you know, you chop off a head and two more heads grow back, you know.
Right.
But in the mythos, Hercules still defeated the Hydra. So we've got to remain
and
knowing that anything can be overcome as well.
And that's why the masculine force has been very, very much, you know, starting to, you know, I feel like spark in some ways.
Definitely.
I can feel rumblings of alignment with men. And it's good because we need to have that masculine force. It's got to come forth. You know, it's got to rise. It has to rise here, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And continue to, you know, be where we're at. We have to become, you know, the men, you know, that are here that, you know, don't break their frame, you know, and they're going to stand in the midst of this whole thing with their lightsaber right up against that fucking Cthulhu. See,
exactly
the Jedi, you know, understanding what that actually means, you know, of, you know, you're holding your lightsaber, your sword in context to, you know, your thought, your emotion, what you're broadcasting, your consciousness, you know, and how your connection with the higher force and everything, and how it's wielding forth through the alchemical process through your physical body as a man. And
beautiful to see.
And this is what's happening. I feel like this, I can feel the spark of this taking place. And it's actually a beautiful thing. You know, I mean, getting into understanding that dream, you know, the octopus trying to pull people down from, you know, from that process, that's, you know, that's that picture, right?
Mm-hmm.
It's that whole picture of, you know, this is my food source. You know, this is how I stay alive.
Mm.
You know?
A parasite.
So, you know, it becomes very, that's a real mind picture. That's a real figure of speech. Or, you know, you can like picture that, you know, in that dream.
Yeah, it's incredible.
Yeah.
And yeah, going back to the divine masculine, yeah, it's that ability to initiate and transmit in alignment, because, you know, the masculine energy, as with the feminine, they've both been distorted and put out of alignment. And then you've got all this other murky stuff going on as well, where it's just trying to get rid of all of it. So yeah, it's really allowing that to really come back online, isn't it? It really is time for that to rise and be, you know, what it's meant to be, the warrior energy, that divine sacred masculine, which is really cool, you know, see that starting to arise, because it's definitely necessary. Because over the last few years, like living in a country town and seeing all these big burly guys wearing masks, and I'm just like, what the fuck? Take your mask on, like, you're men, like, what the? it was hard to watch. So I think after all that, it's definitely necessary, and the attack humanity's genuinely been under, you know, we need our defense. We need our warriors.
Yeah. Exactly. You know, I look at things, in the light of, you know, what I want to see happen, you know, mm-hmm. and not in what's happening, you know, so you can't get pulled into what's happening. You have to have that imagination, right? Mm-hmm. Coming forth in context to your mindset and your ritual, because you are, every day you're the ritual. You get up out of bed, you know, you put your clothes on, you're the ritual, man. You are in the energy. You are here. You are, you know, the physical manifestation of something that you're here to do. Mm-hmm. Your mission, the energy that you carry, the templating you hold, it doesn't matter. You are the ritual. And so you live your life mm-hmm. like that. So you have to learn how to live your life like that ritual. And so as men, yeah, exactly. we need to play out those archetypes, you know, Thor and, you know, the Odin archetype, you know, the Heimdall, you know, the heroes, and let things come mm-hmm. forth in context to that, you know, within the men. And, you know, talking to men out there, you know, I mean, just doing what I do part time, going and seeing all kinds of different people and stuff. Holy shit. I cannot believe I literally see like people at the counter, like guys with like earrings and their hair like back in a braid and like lipstick working like in these places. This is their, you know, this is their men. And they're, I don't know what they are. You know, they call them what?
It's been such a distortion and an attack on this energy for decades now. Yeah.
You know, so it's like,
you look at plastic, you know, all the estrogens and stuff like that.
Oh my gosh. It's
been put into the phytoestrogen.
It's terrible. Yeah. No.
So yeah, getting the testosterone levels back up is probably a good thing for the men.
Absolutely. And that's what needs to be worked on with men, their testosterone levels. There's supplements that I take for my testosterone alone that I take every day to keep my level up. I have to, you know, you got to keep them high. You got to keep them in a place where you're having energy, you know, and where you're, you know, you have that vitality. And it takes work, you know, it takes work to do this shit. You've got to be mindful of who you are and, you know, you can't just, you know, you can't just like do it one day and then not do it for four. You know, you got to be on it. You got to be on it every day.
Yeah, it's a continuous process. Yeah. Especially with supplements and herbs and stuff like that. You're looking at 6 to 8 weeks before you're even usually going to notice much at all with something like that. You've really got to keep that consistency and incorporate that into your daily ritual. It might be when you first wake up, you know, with your breakfast or, you know, whatever way you do it, but honoring that part of the process for healing the body, because the ritual is part of the healing process as well. Absolutely. And solidifying the intention, you know, like you were saying, you've got all these beautiful, you know, supplements and powders and you're making these smoothies and just that process of doing that, you know, you're healing yourself because you're putting that active energy into the morphogenetic field and that's creating that healing, you know, you're tapping into that frequency, which is so important now for all of us as much as we can keep consistent with these things.
You can't.
Now the retrogrades are gone. I'm finding it's a lot easier. It was quite challenging last year. I was doing it, but I had times I'd just feel really a bit of inertia, you know, not able to fully actualize and keep my ritual and my momentum and discipline as good. But this year, since everything's kind of gone back into full, you know, swing, it feels a lot easier. I'm really actually enjoying it. I feel really good with, you know, my daily practice and stuff like that.
Really, you can really feel the shift. I mean, I can feel it. I mean, January, you know, I mean, they had just come out and there was still debris, you know, there was still, you know, stuff that was in the way, you know, and I started to feel that, you know, and it was like really making, and this is where we had to make a lot of choices to clear things out in our own personal lives, you know, as well as what you've had to go through going to New Zealand and dealing with what you've had to deal with. That's all part of that clearing. You know, and that's part of the Yarra Room as well, in context to that clearing, because that's your past, you know, and all those choices and all that stuff that we've gotten, you know, that we get caught in the past, and it's still dictating in our present moment, still having an effect. Mm-hmm. And until we purge that path and it gets released and we release it through our present choices going forward, mm-hmm. you know, when we close that gap, you know, between the past and the future in that present, in this present moment, not having that past, those pulls from the choices of our past now, you know, keeping us out of alignment, it brings us into the place of the mm-hmm. seventh gate of Libra.
Mm-hmm. Libra,
yeah. And
harmony and balance.
That's that you know, that Yarra or Jarra, you know, then that's where the sun can shine, you know, because now you're in that space where you're getting ignited. You know, you're going through the gate of ignition, you know,
mm-hmm.
7 to the 8 to the 9, you know, and then into manifestation to the 10th gate, which is the Saturnian energies. And mm-hmm. so you start to realize that as you flip the Saturnian energies in your life, you know, through choices, then that's when shit really starts to happen for you, you know, and all of this, you know, taking it back to this year, where we're going to really reap a harvest, I think, like,
mm-hmm.
And I'm looking in terms of spiritual gifts, but also physical wealth, I think as well, you know, being an earth mm-hmm. element, but also spiritual giftings that have been, you know, that have been offline for us. We're going to step into those this year. Many of us are.
Yeah. I'm already feeling that.
Yeah.
Really feeling that. I've had a lot of confirmation with this type of thing, with my own path work and my own abilities in terms of intuition and clairvoyance and stuff like that. It's been very profound. And I do accredit that also to the work I have been doing recently with self-practice and keeping a daily self-practice at the moment has really, I've noticed that shift, because before I was doing my practice, but it was only a few times a week and I wasn't as disciplined during those retrogrades last year. And then I was like, at the start of the year, okay, I'm just going to get back to my self-practice, doing some stuff every day that's physical, breath work, yoga, qigong, circle, you know, just all of that.
Right.
And since I've been doing that, I've really noticed, yeah, everything's starting to come back online a lot more, my psychic abilities and stuff like that, my dreams, intuition, like you said about the future, you know, kind of seeing it before it happens, just yeah, the synchronicities and the way they unfold, it's just absolutely astonishing and incredible. So yeah, it does make a difference. It really does. Yeah.
Have you noticed your psychic abilities have been enhanced?
Yes, for sure.
Yeah.
Mm. It's been amazing, actually.
That's been something that I've noticed as well. I mean, I've been having these like epiphanies just, you know, come up, you know, in randomly just by, you know, looking at the energy. And then it's mm-hmm. like it was so weird, man. I was in this restaurant and I was just standing back and I was kind of observing people, and the lady, she brought the steak, and as she was bringing it by me, all of a sudden it was just like inside of me. It's like, oh, that's, and I just looked at the steak. I didn't know it, it was from a distance. And I said, oh, that steak's undercooked. It's going to come back.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not kidding, man. A minute later, they brought the steak back and said it was undercooked.
Wow.
And they made him another one. I'm not shit. I'm like, what the hell? You know, it's like, mm-hmm. I already knew that was going to happen. Like, into the future, mm-hmm. you know, it's like, I was already seeing the energy that was there, that was present, you know, as it was going to wield out. See, that's how we're mm-hmm. our psychic abilities are reading energy now. We're not just like trying to predict something. We're seeing it actually in real time.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it can't mask itself anymore. There's no miasma. There's no mask over things anymore. You know, mm-hmm. that's why they wanted to put the masks on us, because they wanted to keep us in that, you know, in that dream, in that fog. You know, so they did the mask. They pushed that mask ritual. It's still people wearing damn fucking masks. Because I'm just like, you know, and
also cutting people off from their breath, you know, from the breath of life, the prana, the chi, the life force coming through, and our expression through our throat, our voice, all of that getting cut off, not wanting people to express freely. Yeah.
Exactly. So
I think it's going to.
You're Jupiter in Pisces, right? So, you know, you've got that really deep psychic, you know, Piscean energy, you know, that's being amplified mm-hmm. in your life. You know, I mean, some of the stories you told me, man, I'm like, whoa.
Yeah, it's been really quite extraordinary. I love that a lot of the things that have happened to me too have been with other people. Like, it's been a shared thing. So it's not just me going through some kind of thing, you know, like that could be considered a psychosis or something. It's an actual joint synchronicity or some kind of event or experience that has other witnesses. So it's more confirmation. And I've noticed that a lot in network with people recently. It's just the synchronicity is just firing off with each other. You know, the more we get on this path work, the more research and study we do, it's like somebody finds one component and then somebody's got something else, and it's all coming together. And the incredible way it unfolds in this kind of serendipitous way, it's just phenomenal, like actually phenomenal.
You know, that Plutonian energy is starting to push up against that 11th gate.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's almost at 29 degrees now. So, you know, we're really starting to see the power of, not, you know, the full power, you know, in context to wrapping things up to the Capricorn gate now with with Pluto. Now it's going to flux at the gate a few times, but, you know, it's going to make an entrance into Aquarius soon. This is what we're feeling. You know, I think we're feeling this, you know, the synchronicity to come together now, you know, to start to have like a, you know, actual physical coming together. And I think this is going to happen. I think this is going to happen this year as well.
Mm-hmm. I like what you said about the Maverick as well, the Aquarian Uranian Maverick energy. That's really coming out now. Like it was already there, but it feels like that because we had Saturn in Aquarius to a point, but it was also getting kind of restricted by that Saturn. But yeah, that's really going to come out. And through those networks, that 11th house energy is the networks, isn't it? But still, you know, looking at Pluto and where it's at, it's still with Saturn, because originally, you know, Aquarius was ruled by Saturn. So we've still got that Saturn energy there, but it's kind of now coming into a transmutation because we've got Pluto as well. So it's we're able to shift. And I think that's that opportunity to flip the inverse of the reverse 10th gate energy, you know, the domination and control, the lockdown, all that stuff is now being able to be flipped, and we can take Saturn and actually get the reins on Saturn and use Saturn for our own personal discipline, our own personal power, our will force, all that kind of stuff instead. So it's aligning the Saturn energy.
Which, this is how we're going to use the Plutonian energy as well, with self-actualization in context to that Plutonian energy with each one of us, in context
mm-hmm. and alchemy.
The inversions that were used, the Saturnian energy as it was used to build the inverted structures during the needlecraft. So all of that, all those structures going to be tested by Pluto now. See? And mm-hmm. so we could see major breakdowns in context to this, because, you know, because if we're wielding that Plutonian energy correctly, you know, and in our ritual and our thoughts, and bringing it into a place where it's, you know, it is the great transformer, you know, it's going to test all those structures and they're not going to hold water. So there's going to be, you know, there's going to be a reckoning that's going to come with the plutonium energy at some point in that Aquarian gate. It's going to be there for 20 years. So, you know, this is a very long transit, and it's going to really, really test everything in context to this. But if we're wielding it correctly, we're taking that transformative energy of that 11th gate and bringing things to the next level in human consciousness.
Powerful.
Yeah.
I've got Pluto smack bang on my ascendant now. It's just like right there to the degree. So it's quite an interesting transit.
You're integrating, you're integrating that, you know, all that Capricorn energy, man.
Been very initiatory, transformative, intense. Yeah,
you're Capricorn ascendant, right?
But then looking at the transits as well. Sorry, what did you say?
I said your Capricorn ascendant. Yeah, it's really, you're really feeling that. It's almost like a Saturn return, isn't it?
It is. Yeah. It's maybe even more intense, just in a different way. More push to transform. Well, the Saturn return was more harsh lessons for me. This has been more like transform, reach mastery, or die. It's kind of like that vibe.
Right. Yeah.
It's full on.
Exactly. But hey. Yeah. I mean, we all come in
with these templates for a reason.
That's they're going to play out. It doesn't, you know, vibrational correspondence is going to happen. Your templating on the solar spiral is going to play out in context. You know, so there will be scenarios that be set up that you have to walk through and go through and transform and transmute and purge and heal and celebrate, you know, all of it. And once you work out something, you know, between the planetary consciousness, you know, that are squared off or opposing each other, and you work those, you know, you work those out, or conjunctions. You know, you start working that energy out within yourself and getting it congruent, getting it flowing correctly. Man, when that square comes off, when it resolves, it's like nothing you've ever. I mean, all you get upgrades like crazy. People don't realize how powerful the solar spiral is to the actual ascension process. You know, a lot of people just want to bypass it. It's a critical, you know, piece of the puzzle, don't you think?
Oh, for sure. And often people can look at it from a more negative aspect, like, oh no, I've got Saturn squared Pluto or something like this happening as a transit. I'm completely screwed. Instead of seeing, you know, where that goal can actually come from, that forging, and looking at Thor's hammer again, and Thuraz and Haglaz, and these type of rune energy, you know, and really feeding it into us in a way. But that's where the rewards can come. It's the make or break, isn't it? It can either destroy you or transform you and forge you into a stronger version of oneself. That's where the rewards and the gold is, for sure. Mm.
It's like you see the finish line, you know, for this certain period, and you see the finish line and you are absolutely exhausted. You know, you're at that space where you're like, I don't know if I can go anymore. And, you know, you've traveled this, you know, it's like climbing the mountain, you know, it's just right there, but I am so exhausted. I don't know if I can get to the top. And that's where you have to dig deep inside and realize that, number one, there's no turning back. You cannot go back. That's not even an option. Number two, there's no other, you can't stay where you're at, no matter how tired as you are. Because if you stay where you're at, you're going to die. You're not going to keep going. You're not going to become stagnant. And so the third choice is just to continue on at whatever pace that you can do at that time to get where you need to go. And that's, as warriors, that's what we have to do. we have to realize that, you know, the top of that mountain is in our sight. But again, through all the work and all the integration and all the things that we've done, it's been such a hard process. You just, sometimes you're just like, oh my God, just give me a break, will you? And then that's when the higher force comes in and gives you these moments where you just get struck. It's almost like a lightning strike. It's just an energy infusion within yourself, almost like a divine intervention. And it's like comes inside and it hits you. And all of a sudden there's this vitality, there's this upgrade, and there's this passion. And then there's this drive that happens to keep going. And I've had that happen to me at integral parts of this pathwork. You know, talk about that a little bit for you personally.
Me too. Yeah. That goes back to that kind of alchemical process, doesn't it? And I've had many blackening phases where you kind of go into the deep, dark stuff. I've had a lot of external situations that have happened that are just beyond my actual control. You know, it's just a blackening happening all around me, tower moments. And through that, you know, it can feel like you're getting ripped to shreds and you're literally in hell. Like it can be really tough. But then I've had these glimpses or these experiences within that where I've come one-to-one with the divine. It's surged through me in some way, shape, or form. And usually with synchronicity, that's been major for me. My life has just been one big stream of synchronicity. It's absolutely constant. And dreams as well, and meeting the right people at the right time, having the right information just fall in my lap, the right, you know, tools, the way the universe, if you call it that, for lack of a better word, or my higher self, or whatever you want to call it, you know, the higher force has just come through at the right time within that process, within that alchemical process, and kind of provided what I need to keep going with that endurance and to remind me as well of who I am and why I'm here and what I'm doing, and that it's not just for nothing, that it's not just some nihilistic kind of bullshit. There's something very potent to all of this, and there's deep meaning and relevance, you know, when it comes to these personal experiences that you can have with these type of forms of planetary magic, basically, like really experiencing planetary magic. And you can come into your healing phase, your whitening, and the right healers will come, the right herbs will come, the right tools, and then you start to solidify with the reddening, and you get that right information, the knowledge and wisdom, the self-study, the self-practice. And through that, we start to self-actualize, and it's a beautiful process. And then you can look back in retrospect at that experience, that dark night of the soul, that hero's journey that you've just been on, and you can really see how it's transformed you, you know, that you've actually come a long way from where you were a few years prior. And that's a beautiful thing. That's quite an opportunity. And I see my life as full of many amazing opportunities because I've had such intensity. The pendulum swung for me like this. But I wouldn't have it any other way, because that's what I'm here for.
Right.
I know other people and the pendulum's just like this, but this is where the growth is coming for me. So I'm grateful, you know. I wouldn't take any of it back, even the horrific, horrible shit.
Yeah, I mean, if you're not challenged, you know, by the higher force itself, you know, and bringing things into a place where you absolutely have, you know, you have to go through the rites of passage and then and the initiatory rites to even, you know, to forge this path. And this is a lot of what we've lost in our society, because, you know, we basically have a bunch of entitled little whiners now out there thinking that they're entitled to what you have. You know, what you have worked for, you know, a government handout, whatever, you know. And there's this entitlement mindset now that's you know, becoming so toxic within the collective. And, you know, this is something that needs to be purged, because, you know, people don't understand energy. they don't understand how it works. They don't understand, you know, what the concept of everything's energy and, you know, all my, you know, all my choices, my thoughts, my emotions, you know, it all has an impact. And until you realize that, you know, you're just a victim of your own circumstances, you know, and own ignorance. And
that's been perpetuated, the victim cycle. It's almost celebrated within the mainstream. I'm a victim too.
Exactly. It's
crazy. Yeah.
I mean, anybody can play the victim card if they want to, you know, but that's not going to empower you to anything new and any change, any breakthrough. You know, you'll just get the pendulum swing back and forth and back and forth. I mean, I know I saw it in the church where I'm every week, you know, the same people going up to the altar for the same prayer and the same laying on of hands and the same problems that they did last week, asking God to forgive them for their sins, you know, and I'm sitting there thinking to myself, well, you know, you're not doing anything about it, you know?
Yeah.
So they hold into that victim and savior mentality, you know, in context to the disempowerment, you know, and all the while their inertness and stagnation, they're being harvested. They're being, you know, they're being siphoned, not even knowing it.
Yeah, completely unaware, unfortunately. So it's quite a courageous feat to step out of that and see it for what it is and see the times that we've probably all been there, you know, at one stage or another, but to be able to step out of it and go, okay, I'm going to empower myself now with courage and I'm going to take the action that I need to take to actually make that something in this reality and to make that part of who I am on a daily basis. Reframing and re-examining our thought processes and our actions and stuff like that in a more healthy, coherent kind of way that is actually going to make our lives better and forge us as a better human being and be, once again, in our highest potential, like we were saying, you know, stepping into that as much as we can.
You know, I think that as humans, you know, we just naturally have supernatural abilities. It's something that we haven't, you know, we've been, you know, tricked out of, so to speak, you know, and we, you know, so walking in supernatural is like normal for human beings. It should be.
Exactly.
This is our heritage. This is who we are.
When all our DNA was activated, the 12 strand or whatever, we had all those abilities. And I had memories and dreams of this, when we could fly, when we could use telekinetic kind of powers and we were telepathic and it was all there. And then something happened, going back to the procession and the cataclysms and all this kind of thing, you know, that's created this amnesia. But now we're coming back on the grand cycle. So it's time to reactivate that stuff. And I've had so many visions and dreams and stuff to say, that's what's going to happen. You know, that's where we're going with all this. It's like, where's it all going? Well, it might take another 1,000 years, but that's what, who knows? But that's kind of where we're trying to come back to, or not even trying, we are coming back to. We don't want to try because that's kind of,
well, that,
that's not really making it happen.
I mean, this is the deal.
Mm.
We are, we've came here and we're not leaving until the job's done. It takes 1,000 years.
Mm-hmm.
That's the attitude we have to have. You know, what are we doing? We're setting the stage for our next incarnation if it has to happen. Here.
Those foundations.
See, not only with our own soul codes, but also, you know, in context to what we're seeding as a legacy within the collective.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Exactly. Yeah.
You know, I mean, it's like, okay, we are, you know, what legacy are we going to leave with this physical incarnation? You know, and that's, you know, that is the answer. That's the answer to the question and the question to the answer. What legacy? You know, what is it that we are here to do? What is our goal here, you know, to this whole, you know, self-actualizing ourselves into the realm, bringing our energy here and incarnating into this timeline, into this space to, you know, to do the work and bring ourselves into a place where we are actually, you know, leaving a legacy.
Yeah, for sure. So important. And that's fair. in the ruins, isn't it? Fearful, leaving a legacy.
Right. You know, and that's, you know, that's the MC line on your chart. You know, that's the 10th gate. In context to the, you know, the 10-4 axis, your private internal Cancerian energies, you know, all your emotional intelligence, your intuition, you know, all of the beautiful Cancerian energies that, you know, get jammed by our moon, bringing that online into the, and bringing it to the top of the, into manifestation, into the top of Capricorn, you know, to that 10th gate in context to what we're here to manifest, you know, what we're here to transform, you know? And I just think that that is the mastering process in context to the MC line, if you want to look at it to that aspect in a deeper way. And that's why the Saturnian energies have been so fucked with, because they don't want you knowing you can manifest reality. Whoa.
Yeah.
You can manifest reality? See, they don't want you to know that. They don't want you to know that, you know, you are a broadcasting station.
Creator.
Frequency, energy, and power in the physical realm. You know, they don't want you to know that. That's who you are. They don't want you to know that. You know, and that's who we are. You know, we are literally here holding, you know, as we're cleaning and clearing and integrating, we're holding that wave, you know, we're holding the original time. It's frequencies. Okay, we're going to head into a break here. We will be back with more of this awesome conversation. Okay. Having a great time. How are things, just real quick, how are things going in Australia these days?
Overall, it's pretty good right now, you know, for me anyway. It's been good. I've just been on my own personal path work and observing the energies. We're actually having a really cold summer. It's actually the middle of summer. I've had like a big woolly thing on today, and it's interesting. But yeah, things are good. Yeah. How about over there in Kansas?
Actually, it's been pretty nice here lately, the last couple of days. We had that deep freeze, and then, since then, it's been fairly mild winter, not a lot of moisture. So, nothing to complain about, that's for sure. But I think
it was interesting when I was in New Zealand. Yeah.
Go ahead.
In New Zealand, I was in the North Island where they I was driving around. I looked at all this amazing stuff, and then I left. And the day I left, I saw a bit of weather manipulation stuff going on. And the next day, a natural disaster hit. So they had the biggest flood or something that they've ever had, and all these people died, and they closed down the airport. And it was pretty full on. So I got out probably 12 hours before all that happened. So it was quite good timing for me on my behalf, but quite difficult for other people. Yeah, it was pretty interesting to see all that happening while I was there, in terms of energies and what's happening.
That's one thing that you get that we also have with this path work is we do have protection, that's something that you have to keep your state of mind on as well, because mm-hmm. we are protected, and when we're in alignment, running in synchronicity, and we're moving and doing what we're doing, that protection is going to be there for us. We don't have to fear anything. We really don't.
Exactly.
And the same thing in California up there with all these major storms that hit Northern and Central California, just devastated shit, floods and just so much water. Just unbelievable, Yeah. So there's a lot of that going on right now.
Oh yeah. Yeah.
A lot of that going on. Well, I think I want to shift gears here, maybe to talk about some of the planetary alchemy that's going to be going on this year, what we can look for, and how are we going to navigate it and work with it this year. So what do you see going forth this year? Like, what do you, personally, what are you looking at?
I found the Saturn transition going into Pisces. That's quite interesting, especially the way it's quite close to the Pluto transit. We've got both of these major kind of transits happening around a period of time. I'm not sure what to think of that, Saturn in Pisces, because it could be really holding back some of that kind of Neptune energy, some of that, Piscean 12th gate qualities, but maybe that restraint is also for a reason. Maybe we've had too much of that. It could be starting to see things a little bit clearer, because Neptune or Pisces can also be about delusion and confusion and things being distorted as on a more shadow aspect. You've got the qualities of Neptune that are quite beautiful and mystical and magical, and yeah, I love that part of Pisces Neptune, but then you've got that deception. So maybe it will start to break through some of that, and the truth will start to come out. It's interesting. Yeah. What do you think about that?
Yeah. In the mythos, Neptune is the son of Saturn. So they kind of need each other. I see a real big connection between Neptune and Saturn, in context to the energies that both of them wield. Neptune, is very, Neptune's the god of the sea. So everything that you see on the surface isn't what's happening underneath the water. Something totally different's happening on the surface than what's happening underneath the water. There's a whole nother world of marine life under the water that exists in its own, environment. And so Neptune becomes, the imagination of your dream. Your dream state, your dream life, your dream world, your what you can dream, your I nation, what can you bring forth into reality, through that process of working with Neptune. And the delusions and illusions that happen happen because we don't have awareness, and we're still in that fog, we're still in that miasma, and that's where the delusion and illusions get wielded, you know, to your own rationalizations, your own disempowerment, you know, thinking, you know, your own egotistical bullshit as well. All that's illusional, you know. And so, so Saturn comes into the gate and says, okay, so we're going to bring reality check time. So to the 12th gate, it's bringing a reality check of all the shamanic energy and all the, you know, the energy of Neptune, your psychic abilities, everything's going to be tested with this transit. It's going to be a very powerful transit. I have Saturn in Pisces. You know, so that's where my
Saturn sits.
So I'm having my Saturn return this year. So all of that energy then is very powerful because it starts to really hone your skills. So this is what Saturn does that people don't realize. It's a honer. It grinds the wheel slowly, but it hones you. And this is an opportunity these next, you know, 2.5 years for our abilities to really be honed to that, you know, that 12th gate, those 12th gate energies, those Neptune energies. And you have to look at it in light of that, you know, and not say, oh shit, man, I'm, you know, Saturn's coming in my gate, man. It's going to, you know, it's going to block me. You know, I get it. Well, it's going to block certain things because there's things need to be cleared. And once you clear it, it'll open up. And then Saturn moves on, and you know to another thing. You're not there anymore. So yeah, it's going to be actually. I'm really looking. I'm looking forward to that transit actually, because
we've got the Venus in Pisces energy right now too.
Exactly, because Saturn will not only be transiting itself, my own natal Saturn, it'll be transiting my Chiron, it'll be transiting my Moon as well. See?
Yeah. A lot of Pisces energy. Yeah.
Right. So I got all three of those orbs within the 12th gate, you know, not counting the 12th house in Pluto. And all that runs through it. So when Saturn's transiting all that, you know, I'm seeing it in context to a tremendous opportunity for my own life to have major breakthrough.
Mm-hmm.
So
really refining your abilities as an astrologer and as a mystic and right. as a mage. Yeah, it's really that opportunity with that type of transit. Yeah, if the work is put in, you can really do that. Yeah, beautiful. Yeah.
Absolutely. That's how I see Saturn. You know, I see it like that. I see, you know, Saturn being, you know, the, you know, yes, it's the taskmaster, but it's also it's discipline. And, you know, being mm-hmm. able to take that, you know, that those transits and really level up, you know, my discipline, you know, the discipline within my own life. And that is, you know, honing the skills. So, you know, we all have these abilities with this transit, just because I have, you know, I have, you know, gates there, whatever, you know, you have Jupiter there. I mean, you're going to have transits that are going to happen, you know, with your Piscean energy. Yeah. Well, you know, so uh-huh. I see it as a tremendous opportunity for us, you know, here in the next 2.5 years going into, you know, 2025, really making, you know, making a level up with our, you know, our abilities.
Yeah, which is excellent. Mm. Mm. And then we've got, you know, Uranus and Taurus is just still there. That's an interesting one too. And Mars just pulling in Gemini, just continuing on in that long Mars transit. That's been challenging for me, the Gemini Mars, far up.
And that
long Mars transit.
That Mars, like forever, it feels like, man, in Gemini.
I know, I'm like, when are you going to stop? So when Mars moves out of Gemini, what are we going to see?
Mars,
there, do you think?
Mars will move.
When it finally moves.
We'll move into the Cancer energies. It's bringing, you know, it's bringing you an opportunity to really ignite the self-care within your life, to ignite, you know, your, you know, to really, you know, level up your home experience, you know, creating more of a sacred space, you know, creating more of a space where you are, you know, nurturing yourself in your own home and in your private life, you know, and then honing your intuition as well, you know, in context to, you know, the passion of this path work. Mars in water signs has a rough time because, you know, you got the fire and the water, but this is a great place for us to create fire with fire and water. And so it's coming into that fourth house, you know, and it's initiatory energies, and it's like, okay, bring it on. Let's do it. You know, great time to level up your own self-nurturing and self-care as well. Yeah. Mars and Gemini, it's been a rough one, I have to say.
Yeah. Especially with the retrograde. It's intense.
That was a long retrograde with Mars, man. Holy crap.
But we have to see what is the lesson there. Yeah. What was that all about for humanity, for the collective at this time?
We had to use it to, you know, to really, you know, pull back on things, you know, to really recalibrate. It's a great recalibrating moment or time period for all of us in context to the pulling back in the retrograde. You know, and realigning our thought process, realigning our values, realigning what's important to us, you know, and how we're how we're communicating. How we're making a difference with our communications and looking at things in context to that. How we're expressing ourselves, how we're bringing the communication out. And I think that it's been a great transit for a lot of us, especially if you have Gemini, you know, energies going on, to also really start to realize how powerful our communication is now. Like when we speak, it has weight, it has authority, you know. We're not just out here just speaking. We're speaking because what we're speaking matters, number one. And number two, we're speaking it with authority, you know, and strength. And I think that was a lot of the lesson as well in context of the pullback, is releasing a lot of that fear communicating, you know, with, you know, out there. And then our own internal dialogue as well, you know, taking a good look at it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, really facing the mirror with all those other retrogrades and everything. It's been coming up for review. Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. And you know what happens? The more you clear, the more you heal, the more you feel these transits.
Mm-hmm.
You know, exactly. You actually feel them. I mean, it's not just like, oh, something's transiting in the sky. No, you actually feel it. It's actually happening to you. You know, and you feel it, you know, on an etheric level, physical level, all the way down. You feel it because those are the energies that are running through the ethers, man. You know,
I've had it to the degree, like things have gone 0 degree into something, and I've just noticed a shift in my own energy and the collective energy. A good example is just the Pisces Venus thing, you know, just feeling that shift just is different. It was kind of this somber, beautiful, bittersweet kind of vibe going on. Like, yeah, it's quite emotive and very different energy. So yeah, you can really feel those transitions as they move to the degree, which is really fascinating.
It is, you know. And then, you know, all of the other aspect that's going on is that Uranus and Taurus, and you know, that has really been a very intense transit. You know, what are we dealing with here? You know, I mean, Uranus is all about what change and, you know, level up and, you know, being uncomfortable and being a maverick, you know, being unpredictable, you know, awakening, all of this stuff, rebel. Where Taurus is like, you know, oh man, I just want my comfort. You know, I just, I want my
sleep a lot.
Comfort, my sleep, just let me alone, you know, and Taurus energy can be lazy at times, you know, and
essential.
And you just want to, you know, it's like, oh my God, give me that extra 2 hours of sleep. You know what I mean? It's like, you know, you just, that Taurus, you know, I mean, I know I'm a stellium Taurus. I know all about it. So you start to like look.
Lovely hot meal. A warm bed.
Right. Yeah. So you start to look at it in the very polar opposites of each other. Uranus energy, man, is like, hey, man, we're going to shake up that world. We're going to shake up your world, man. We're going to make you uncomfortable, you know?
Yeah.
And that's what this is all about. This transit is to make, you know, make us uncomfortable. If you want to take it to the age of Taurus in context to what's still here, to the distortions of all of that bullshit. You know, you were talking about the cataclysmic events. You know, major cataclysmic event was that wormhole that got opened up in Saqqara, Egypt. You know, that was devastating to everything. I mean, literally, like, they're talking about now about, like, this, a lot of these events that took place on the planet happened not in years or tens of hundreds of thousands, you know, tens of thousands or thousand years or to whatever, happens in weeks and months now.
Yeah, suddenly. Yeah.
Like, it wasn't like, oh, this happened over time. This happened as an event. I mean, it literally, like, changed the face of the earth.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I've been to Saqqara, and it's, you can see that some kind of blast or something's happened there. There's lots of fragments of things on the ground. I found a few pieces of crystal alabaster, like, that would have been bowls or vases or some kind of things, but they're all just shattered. Everything's just shattered all over the ground, and there's still pillars of this ancient building that's there. And you know, you've got the pyramid and this tomb, but the tomb's like a big pile of rubble. You know, inside the tomb, it's still immaculate, and there's all this tiny hieroglyphic writing. But the actual site is just like a big pile of rubble and mess. You know, something big went down there for sure. You can really feel that vibe when you're there. Yeah.
Oh wow, I've never been there.
Yeah, it's a crazy place. Yeah.
But I think, you know, that I was
lucky to actually experience it.
That was definitely, you know, an event that happened on the earth, you know. And, you know, when you start to really look at it, you start to realize that the whole desert, that 33rd parallel coming across from Egypt all the way across into the United States, you know, how that land was connected at one time. You know, taking it all the way in, we you know, we're looking at what? You know, this is Egypt.
This
whole area that's been broken apart in context to where the United States is, that's all Egypt. You know, the Grand Canyon, all that area, taking Southern California all the way down. And that was all connected at one time. And so, you know, what parched the earth into such a place that it created a desert? You know, you know,
you can see it when you look on, you know, aerial views of maps and stuff, and you can see it's like a blast, you know, it's like something really scorched the land there. There's almost like a mark across that whole kind of equatorial region of the earth. It's pretty crazy. Yeah,
it is. Crazy.
And Australia itself is like that as well. It's its own crazy blast. Something big went down here too, for sure.
I know, right? Maybe even longer. You start to see how the land was literally like just torn, you know, and ripped, and you know, something had to do that. I mean, that just doesn't happen.
No,
you know, so we're really dealing with, you know, we're dealing with really ancient stuff here, and you know, going back to the age of Taurus with all this Uranus in transit. Yeah, that's going on. It's really awakening the aspect of what needs to be healed with that particular time period within us as a human race, still carrying the baggage from these, you know, these Bronze Ages, you know, where we're, you know, we're carrying, the woundedness and the pain from those timelines. And,
you know, isn't that Mithras? You know, the mythos, you know, and
know, so you're dealing with
the thrust and those kind of things.
And the whole idea of, you know, the fertility aspect there and being able to realize that, you know, that bull or that Taurus age where shit went down, man, you know, that has to be healed. It has to be healed, you know? And I think this Uranus transit.
But you can also go back to Fehu being the cattle, you know, and the cow and the bull and that rich rewards that can come from that. And that creator energy that comes from, you know, the wealth of Fehu or, you know, Arumbala or however you say it in the Norse mythos, the creator cow. And, you know, it's all kind of the more non-inverted aspect of this energy.
Right.
So kind of wanting to embody those aspects of Taurus. Yeah. Yeah.
And interesting, you know, Uruz as well is also, you know, the ox. So the first two runes of the Futhark are a cow and an ox.
An ox, exactly. And the ox is that hard work, isn't it? It's like that.
Right. So, exactly.
Saturnalian energy. Yeah.
Right.
Mm.
Yeah. You know, so you're dealing with, you know, sowing, you know, tending with the ox, you know, plowing out the garden, plowing out the fields, you know, that type of energy, you know, and then, you know, taking it all the way through to, you know, to Jera, which is the 12th month to the harvest, kicking it back to the harvest of everything that you've plowed, you know, all the resources that you've had to do the work all the way through the Futhark, you know, to that 12th rune where that harvest starts, that comes. You know, for that aspect. And I think that's where we're at right now with this year. I think we're going to have major, major harvests going on with us. You know, we have to level up here to meet or, you know, basically transcend what's going on this planet. Literally, like, stuff is, I mean, we could see an unraveling unprecedented that we've never seen before with this planet at some point.
It's quite possible.
I mean
gotta be prepared for everything.
And it's not because it's a bad thing. It's because it's a necessary thing. It actually needs to happen.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so exactly. The correct foundations can be put down. And you know, and I think, you know, we have to keep forging. We have to keep the path. We got to keep, you know, keep moving, because, you know, it depends on it. I mean, we are here and there's no other way to go but forward. And we have to continue to push forward. We have to, you know, we need that Thorazaz energy, that breakthrough energy. You know, we need it, you know, and we need the Wunjo, you know, the joy, you know, of
joy
and the joy of our work and labor, you know, putting that joy into it which is passion, you know. And so, you know, those two runes are very similar, you know, in context to how they look, you know. One is almost like you're breaking through, you know, with your heart, you know, with Thorazaz, and then you're experiencing Wunjo, you know, with, you know, with your mind and your life force energy, you know, as you're breaking through stuff, you know, things are just being just, you know, chiseled away.
Coming into the high heart.
Right, exactly.
Wunjo even looks like an axe or something, you know, it's got
You know? So you're just dealing with, you know, you're dealing with, you know, major, you know, major energies here, you know, with Thorazaz and Hagalaz, you know, and that's, you know, those are two runes that nobody likes to, you know, work with too much. But I can tell you that, you know, you have to work with Hagalaz. Got to work with it, man.
Thorazaz has come up a lot for me. Yeah.
You got to work with Thorazaz. You've got to, because that's, you know, that, and on the solar spiral, that's working with Saturn, you know, it's working with your Mars energy, you know, I mean, it's, you have to work with it, you know? And this is why so many people, you know, they start this work, but then they, you know, they don't follow through and they fall off the road. And then they're just, you know, they're a casualty at that point. You know, well, maybe you'll get it next time around. You know, I don't know.
Yeah. But going back to Thura, so
yeah.
That's also Monier, isn't it? Like Thor's hammer. You know, that
it is exactly.
But it's also the thorn, the giant. Yeah.
Right.
So it's a powerful symbol, you know, Thor's hammer. It's breaking through the bullshit, killing the giants, you know, the Svartalfafar and Jotun and all that kind of thing. Yeah.
Yeah, which is dealing with the East in context to your ego. You know, we're not.
Yeah, and shadow, yeah.
Ego, but we have to bring the ego into alignment. So, you know, there has to be breakthroughs through that, you know, through that hardness, man. You know, and that's what Thorazaz does. It breaks down, you know, it breaks down the hardness and the tyrannical, narcissistic aspect of your ego, you know, that we, you know, so dear to ourselves, you know. And it's like, you know, once you start working with it, you start to realize that, you know, you got a lot of work to do. And this is why the runes are such a great helper, this oracle, you know, because they really help you to, you know, to really overcome. And I can tell you, man, working with the runes, you know, these past 5 years has been, you know, a real life changer. You know, I don't pull runes. I don't pull my own runes. I don't pull my own tarot. I don't do any pulls for myself because I, you know, the systems aren't designed that way. I don't think, you know, I think they're designed to work with the archetypes and energies. And if you're going to do a reading, have someone do the reading for you, you know, don't, I just don't like doing my own reading. Because I'm, you know, my energy's not neutral sometimes, you know, so it's going to affect the outcome of the reading, you know. So you need a neutral space, a neutral, you know, connection that can read that isn't caught in, you know, in the circumstance. And that's where the neutral party comes in, like, you know, whoever's wielding the you know, the energy then can do the reading for you. And that's how
I find with the runes that come up for me in situations, it's almost like, okay, this is really, like we're talking about Yara or, you know, or Haglars or, you know, that there's been these moments where I'm like, this is a moment of this energy, you know, that is coming into my life. And I really start to look at it and then it starts coming up in all these different ways, you know, whether it's yourself talking about it or, some other people in network who have been doing this amazing ritual where they've been toning a rune every day, every week, going up onto a mountain and singing the rune and having that energy of the rune come through into their lives, like almost like that's part of their lesson and experience for that time as an energetic signature. So really seeing those energetic signatures of the runes within our daily lives and our experiences is really cool.
Those are great. Great synchrony, you know, when those start to happen, you know,
sure.
That's just telling you, it's just confirming the energy. See,
mm.
It's confirming your, you know, your dialogue within yourself, your path work. And I think we need those times, you know, it's like, I'm driving home from the lake today and I'm like doing that video, Year of the Harvest, Jera, you know, and I'm thinking to myself, you know, I'm driving and I pull up and then there's this big trailer that pulls in front of me, you know, like one of those travel trailers with the truck pulls in front of me. And I'm thinking to myself, man, and I said to myself, I feel as free as I've ever felt in my life right now.
Beautiful.
And on the back, as it pulled in front of me, on the back of it was the big words, freedom.
That's fantastic.
So you're just like, okay, wait a second here. Wait, you know, rewind, slow down. What? You know, and the license plate was 911. You know, and I'm just like going, what? you know? So, you know, so taking it back to the 11, you know? Yeah. 9, 10, taking it back to the 11th gate, the 11th freedom, Uranus. It's just like, I'm just like going, holy, you know, it just, that kind of stuff blows my mind sometimes.
Yeah, it's same.
Manifesting like in seconds.
Mm,
in front of me at times. You know, it's crazy.
Yeah. Mm.
You know?
I was thinking today about the pillar, which, you know, you could say with the 11-11 is also, I think that the Jed, in terms of Jedi, doesn't that mean the pillar? Am I correct with that? I read that somewhere recently.
It makes
the Egyptian concept of the Jed, in terms of the Jedi, is in relation with the pillar, which is kind of like that.
Yeah.
Yeah, that gate energy, you know, coming through or becoming that, becoming the gate or the pillar.
Right. Mm. Yeah.
And I just thought of that with the 9-11. Huh. Wow. The pillars and the spindle.
Yeah, that's interesting. Yeah, wow. Yeah, and that's the other thing, you know, as I was driving, I was thinking about how that's, you know, that particular number is inverted to distress.
Mm-hmm.
Call 911, call 911. Yeah. I mean, they even used it when they dropped the towers, 9-1, you know, 9-11, you know.
Exactly.
I mean, it's mm-hmm. always been put out there as a distress, you know, as, mm-hmm. as, you know, as something that is, you know, a distressful situation, you know.
Yeah, and, fear. Yeah,
evoking fear with those numbers, and so they run those numbers on rehearsal for a reason. You know, there's a reason why those numbers are ran like they're ran. You know, in context to that. So I thought it was just really cool this morning when I was driving back, and I was like, "Holy crap! That's impressive." You know, getting those kind of synchronicities that fast. It's like, holy shoes, man. This is where we're at, though. I mean,
yeah.
I think our intent, our manifestations are going to really increase in their power and their authority and their speed.
It is, certainly. It really is. Yeah. I need to start writing things down. I write some of the things down, but the level of experience in terms of synchronicity and confirmation, experiences like what you're saying, just continuously occurring. You become quite just, okay, this is another one. Thank you very much. it's quite beautiful. Yeah, it's really, really incredible. Yeah. And with that, it's been that reminder not to have that fear, you know, that it's that confirmation of the divine. You know, I really learned to be more fearless within myself through these experiences. Because yeah, they can't play on that anymore. If you know what you're connected to and what you want, it's it transcends that. Yeah, the fear is bullshit, really.
To know that you're protected, to know that you are, you know, in alignment, it's a great. It's a great. You know, man, it just feels good. I don't even know how to describe it. It just feels good.
Mm-hmm.
You know, to know that, you know, you are having these synchronicities and you're activated. You were literally activated, you know, and then keeping your mindset there in context to that, you know, you are protected. You are, you know, your mind, your body, everything is protected, you know,
mm-hmm.
I love that, man. I love that about this work.
Mm. Yeah.
No, there isn't any fear left, you know, for that. I mean, I'm protected.
Mm. Yeah. I had a dream about that the other night where I met my aunt who had died recently. And I saw her in the afterlife, you know, and she was just radiant and divine and beautiful. And the connection was just so incredible. And it just was a reminder, you know, that even with death, you know, we don't have to fear it. You know, there's no fear of death, so why should there be fear? You know, like, it's just another chapter in everything. But what we're doing here now is so precious and incredible. But it just kind of reminded me of that. This life, you know, it's really phenomenal and beautiful. But when it ends, I don't need to fear either. You know, there's
exactly.
There's a lot more to everything.
Yeah,
I mean, we're infinite. You know, in that sense.
we're here for the long haul. We're not here, you know, what we're here for. And so, you know, it's not like we haven't died before. I mean, you know, I mean.
Oh, so many times.
So it's, you know, it's all rooted in trauma, you know, and that's, you know, in pain. But, you know, the idea of being able to transmute death, you know, the ultimate alchemical rites of passage, that's where, you know, that's where we need to be thinking about, right? I mean, isn't that the goal here, is to be able to,
the goal of alchemy,
of alchemy, is to transform the body into into a place of coagulation, where this particular element of this body now is become, you know, transformed and transfigured.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, without the amnesia of that kind of infinity loop, you know, that we've most of us have been in for so long. You know, the birth, death, amnesia, we forget, we come back, we have to remember again. You know, that alchemy is being able to hold everything and not forget to actually remember who we are and yeah, pull in those fragments and make wholeness again. Yeah, that's
right. Yeah, because the more work the more work you do with that, the more whole your soul is going to continue to be. And you know, and the less miasma you're going to have, you're going to be integrating, you know, integrating into the timeline on a much higher level with each incarnation as you come through, and that's part of the process, you know, is bringing it back and catching up the soul cycle in context to that. And I think that I think that many of us are here to do that right now, but we're also here on a collective level to you know, break this shit down here, man. Literally break it down.
Exactly.
You know.
And going back to the alchemical metallurgy, you know, you had the lead was the, you know, original thing that they had to transmute into gold. And the lead is that association with Saturn again, and the gold being the sun, you know, and all the planetary correspondence in between. Mercury being Quicksilver, Venus being copper, you know, and all these components of that transition, and how there's this kind of above, so below thing going on, you know, like it's a multi-level thing. It can be the metallurgy, but it can be our consciousness at the same time. This is a symbolic process, but it's, yeah, it's very interesting how that all correlates. And yeah, the connections between the planets and the alchemical substances that we use and stuff like that. I've been looking at that recently, in terms of even healing, you know, working with, for example, silver, with the lunar energy, for example, and how that can help with feminine aspects, in ancient kind of medicine and stuff like that. They were quite aware of these type of things. They were using copper for medicine as well. And yeah, and that's starting to come back again, like people becoming aware of how we need to actually up our copper intake. You know, everyone talks about, you know, iron deficiency and stuff like that, but we can't absorb iron without the copper. So if we don't have that copper intake, our bioavailable copper there, we have the iron in our body, but it oxidizes, and that oxidative stress creates aging and decay. So we need that conductive copper, which is correlated with Venus, I think, to heal. So yeah, it's interesting. It's all coming out. Yeah,
what foods have copper in it, do you know?
Beef liver is a big one, but also, yeah, that's really high in copper, but there's also, you know, getting your soil to be remineralized and being able to grow foods in high mineral soil, because we've had monoculture farming for so long, it's become depleted. So copper being a trace mineral is not so much in the soil. Also, people used to get it from their pipes, like with their water, because in the old days they had the copper pipes, but now it's all plastic and poly and all this stuff. So beef liver is a good one. You know, if you can get your copper levels up with the magnesium and the iron, it creates a bit of a synergy. There's a really cool book about it I just read. It's called Cure Your Fatigue. Really suggest checking that out. It's really cool.
Yeah. And it also helps with the zinc uptake as well, as far as I understand as well.
Yeah, I think the zinc can actually, too much zinc can inhibit the copper in the iron. So yeah, you've got to kind of rebalance it all. And the copper is a key component of that.
Yeah.
And of course, the magnesium. So yeah. It's interesting how these things are.
Yeah, it's your magnesium.
And not getting synthetic versions, of course. You want to get these substances from natural based things as much as you can. Yeah. All these synthetic vitamins and that are doing more harm than good.
Right. Yeah. So, you know, so the physical alchemical process is very important as well for us to understand in context to the apothecary and how we're doing that particular physical alchemy with our own body, you know, what we need at a certain time or whatever, you know, and that plays into the role of Neptune, because Neptune can reveal certain things about that within your dream state. If you pay attention, you know, if you pay attention to your dream state, it can tell you a lot about what's going on, you know, where your consciousness is wielding and where things are at in context to that. And you can literally pull that out of the dream state and bring it into manifestation, you know, work with Saturn to do that, you know? And so Neptune then becomes a conduit from your dream state, your dream world, into a space where you actually can bring it into physical reality, work with it, and then bring it into a place where you can actually use that energy. So every waking time, whether you're dreaming, whether you're conscious, you know, or you're in your dream body, or where, you know, wherever, you're working with all of it. Nothing is being wasted.
Yeah, it's all relevant. Hey, I've had a lot of dreams like that.
Right.
Quite amazing messages. Yeah.
Right. Yeah. Stuff coming up. Those are things that need to be paid attention to, you know, mm-hmm. When you're in your dream state, you know, look at your dreams, you know, where are they keyed into, you know, what symbols are you seeing in your dreams? What figures of speech, how are they aligning with where you're at, and what are they telling you? And it's very good to set that down. We have to really have a powerful dream life as mages. I think it's important, don't you?
Oh, for sure. Yeah. The dreams that I've had, especially in the last few years since I've had some big initiations and activations happening, they've been really, really incredible and great messages that have been able to, I've shared with others and assisted them with that process. Or I've had prophetic dreams where things have actually happened afterwards, or I feel they are happening. So yeah, it's quite a magical experience to have that. For example, seeing the white dragon, that was a pretty cool dream. And the white dragon came to me in terms of prophecy and stuff like that.
Right.
Have this fully grown, beautiful white dragon standing in front of me, and just the energy that he had, it was just so beautiful. And a year prior to that, I dreamt of his egg. I saw his egg and it hadn't hatched. And then a year later, I see the dragon fully hatched and grown. And he said to me, the energy of that, of him, is with us all, or whoever is able to hold it, basically. It left me with a really beautiful feeling of peace. And just knowing, like, it's all good, you know, we're going to be okay here.
So if you're listening to this podcast, make sure you start, you know, if you don't have a good memory, you know, start journaling down your dream world.
Mm.
It's a good thing. I mean, I happen to have a photographic memory when it comes to dreams, so I can recall about every detail, but some people can't do that. You got to write it down. So I would say that, you know, try to write down your dreams when you feel that there are significant shifts going on, and, you know, go back and look at them and revisit them, because I think there's a lot of things that you can catch that we can use in helping to level up our, you know, our abilities and our consciousness here in context. And that white dragon thing is really cool.
Yeah. Something that really helped me with my dreams recollection. Many years ago, when I had some time, I spent a month just writing down a few pages every morning when I first opened my eyes. I just had the book there. You know, you grab your book, start writing it down straight away before you do anything else. And it could be just one page, it could be three, just as much as you can get out.
Right.
And that repetition, it just really helps with the conscious, unconscious thing, like bridging the conscious and unconscious. And then you begin to have more clarity. And it can also really help your writing ability, because you're writing from the unconscious and bringing it into consciousness. Yeah, it's a really cool process. And reading back on it a few months later is even better. Just the revelations and the knowledge that you can get from doing that is really cool. So if you have problems with remembering your dreams, that's a really good one. Even if you wake up and you don't actually remember the dream, you just write about how you're feeling and what's going on in that moment.
Point.
Yeah. And it just opens you up. Yeah. And enables that to become more clear. Mm.
That's a really good point. Yeah. Mm. Neptune rules the dream world, you know, so, mm-hmm. you know, so, in, you know, looking at your Neptune placing as well, you know, is very powerful to that aspect, because it can kind of tell you a lot about your dream world and you know, how you're wielding things to it, you know? So I think we limit ourselves in a lot of ways still. But I think that, you know, a lot of us are really starting to kind of grab a new, like this new fire inside of us. It's almost like it's right there, man. And that passion to keep going, that passion to keep forging and creating higher awareness, creating, you know, more synergy with each other and bringing ourselves into a place where we're really advancing our soul expression, you know, on into the collective, into the reality, into the ethers. And I think that going forth here with this, you know, with this Plutonian energy moving into Aquarius, this is really going to be a major shift for all of us, you know, especially if you're holding any kind of 11th gate energy in your chart, you know. I mean, I look at it to, where is my Uranus? Where is my 11th gate placings? And then take a look at, you know, where those are aspecting on your chart. And it kind of give you a picture of how maybe some of the things that you need to work with, you know, to, you know, planetary alchemy and archetypal consciousness, where things are aspecting to, you know, to your 11th house, you know, and what's transiting your 11th house and, you know, on down the line. I think it's a very powerful aspect that we can definitely work with, you know, and I hope that people can really start to see the value in working with these arts of gnosis on a new level. I mean, honestly, just asking you this question, I mean, how would we do it if we didn't have these arts of gnosis, you know, to help us, you know?
We'd be in the dark, wouldn't we? Yeah, this is so valuable. Yeah. The more we learn, the more we grow through these archetypes and arts of gnosis, we can really start to see things clearer and empower ourselves and just have more knowledge of what's at hand, what's actually going on here. If we didn't have those symbols, those archetypes, we'd be completely clueless, wouldn't we? We'd be lost. and that's, yeah, when people get raked out and they end up getting mind controlled because they're not connected to that. Yeah.
Right. That's right. So, you know, we have a great opportunity now for us to step into here this year. And, you know, I just really feel like that everything that we've really, you know, you put in a lot of hard work and worked for, you know, up to this point, honestly, I mean, there was a point, you know, last year, all these retrogrades were hitting and stuff. I was thinking to myself, where is the reward for all of this? I was thinking to myself that, like, why am I doing all this? Where is the reward? You know, where is the, you know, the gebbo, the gift from going through all of this cleansing and purging and shadow work and transformation and transmutation aspect, where is the reward? I can feel like the reward is, the yera, the harvest of this, the energy that we've sown into it coming back to us, magnifying back, echoing back from the universe, is going to be this year for us.
The fruits of our labor.
The fruits of our labor.
Actually ripening.
Exactly. Yeah. Cornucopia, right? I mean, all the harvest of the fruits and the fruits off the tree, And I think that, we deserve this. We've worked for this. We have labored for this time. And now it's time for us to reap. And we are going to reap this year, and it's going to be powerful. And I just, I want everybody to know, to be encouraged that, even though sometimes it feels like, maybe you're not making a lot of progress, or you feel like, oh my God, this is so hard, think of the alternative, I think you can go back into the matrix and just eat that steak and know it's so juicy. And I know the matrix is telling me it tastes so good, and I don't want to know anything about anything else. I just want to know this. You know, that ignorance is bliss bullshit.
Mm.
Look, you can't go back to that. Once you see it, you're responsible for it. You're responsible for your path work. You're responsible for taking the horns of the altar. You're responsible to become the goat. Your individual path work to the Capricorns, the turning energies, you are responsible once you see it, And we can play this woke, quote unquote, woke game all day long about the conspiracy theories and the balloons that are flying around in fucking China and, all the bullshit that's happening and distractions of the world, and all the occult symbolism and everything that's thrown into the grids, in context to all this, and you see it all, that doesn't mean you're awake. Mm,
mm. It's just the first veil, isn't it?
Yeah, you're still dealing with all the sorcery of the first veil. Mm. It's just in a different form now, because you have some knowledge about things.
Mm.
Awake.
There can still be a lot of fear with all that too, hey? A lot of
exactly. Being awake is knowing who you are.
Mm.
As a sovereign, universal sovereign being, who are you really? See? And why are you here?
Yeah. It's a profound journey, isn't it?
It is.
And it's interesting. This spiral has come up in the sky again. And I just saw a post about it, people talking about the spiral. And I had this really incredible experience with the spiral when that one in Norway happened back years and years ago. And I was on the beach, and I stayed on the beach all night at this very sacred place, this really powerful beach. And I was up all night, and I saw some real phenomena that night. And when the sun rose, I looked across at the sand, and there was this 27-ring spiral in the sand, dry sand, and it was perfect, like a crop circle, geometrically, just absolutely divine, 27 rings all coming out. And I sat in the center of it, and I remember everything just went magenta pink. I was like, wow. And all these morning walkers start coming past, and I'm like, look at this. And they're like, oh, did you make it? Like, okay. That was really incredible. And then I went and I saw a friend, and then she starts telling me about, because I told her about what happened, and she goes, oh, there was this spiral in the sky. I saw it like on the internet the other night in Norway, and they're saying it's a missile, but it looks like this portal opening up. And it was at the same time I was out on the beach that night.
Wow.
And I found that at 5 in the morning, the sun came up, I find this spiral manifests in the sky in Norway. So it was pretty trippy. So is that us on the galactic spiral? That's what I wonder. This is the spirals of creation. It's showing, all these, phenomena is part of who we are, part of our consciousness.
Yeah, the 27 is the 9.
Yeah, exactly. It goes back to nine again. Yeah, I thought that was cool. Mm, yeah.
Wow.
So to see it come back this week or whenever it happened, I was like, oh, cool. Okay, full cycle. Excellent. I think it's
these are the type of mystical experiences we need to, you know, we're walking in, you know, and think about it as in context to that leveling up now, you know, with our, you know, with our consciousness, our path work, what we're doing. I mean, we could step into some major healing gifts, some major stuff, man. You know, the 4400, did you ever see that show, you know, where they came back and they had all these abilities? Like one woman had the ability to heal water. So polluted water, wow. She could literally put her hands down in the water and then the water would just clear out. Like all the pollutants in the water would just like become, you know, she'd transmute the water, you know, just crazy shit. We don't realize how much ability that we actually have because the mind is so powerful. And I think, you know, we've been so limited as a human race for so long, and under the slave mentality, under the taskmaster of the inverted Saturn energies, you know, and then of course the jamming of the moon in context to the matrix of that, you know, to your thought and emotion, and then swung on the pendulum back and forth in context of triangulation, how things are triangulated in on with us, you know, to all the polarity issues and you know, right and left and all the bullshit that you know, we've just lost our way as a human race. We've forgotten who we are. You know, we just have a major case of amnesia.
Yeah, it's huge. Yeah. But yeah, some of us are starting to glimpse, you know, we're peeling back the layers. And yeah, like I said to you the other day, we're still in kindergarten, but it's better than being infantile, isn't it?
Right. Exactly. You can't be limited in context to, you know, an incarnation or, you know, I'm a Pleiadian or I'm whatever, you know. Well, maybe that's part of your templating or whatever, but it's not who you are.
Yeah. Not who we are right here, right now.
That's like saying I'm German, or that's like saying I'm, I'm from wherever, you know. It's just a classic thing, you know.
Multifaceted aspect of self.
He's Pleiadian or she's Pleiadian, you know, whatever, Arcturian, you know.
Yeah.
I want to use all these terms, you know, in context of the solar spiral, but, you know, I can't tell you where my moon placing is, you know. I don't know, you know, I'm not watching my transits, so I don't know. Maybe Pluto is, you know, maybe it's trining up with my moon to, you know, for a while. You know, and that's why I'm having all this shit go on. I don't know. You know, I mean, it's very simple to see, you know, once you look at it, you know, but you can get caught in, again, those Neptune illusions about being something that you really aren't, or it's maybe a portion of what you are, but it's not who you are truly. When you get caught in those traps, you know, you got to be careful.
Yeah. False identities and stuff like this. Yeah.
Right.
Kind of go into a type of spiritual bypassing where you're just like, I'll just affirm this false identity instead of actually face the mirror and see who I really am,
right.
And what I've done over the lifetimes and incarnations. And
I think you know, people get caught in that stuff, you know, and it's easy to get caught into the emotional aspect of it and sensationalism, you know, of it, you know, makes you feel important or whatever. I don't know, you know, but, you know, self-worth and self-validation and knowing who you are and, you know, making choices in alignment to your will force, your ego aspect is some of the most powerful things you can do, you know? And you know, whether you're from Arcturian or Pleiadian or wherever, it doesn't change the fact that you have to navigate cosmic principle. So.
And master the temporal realm here in Midgard, on Earth. You know?
Human consciousness mastering, you know, Midgard, you know?
Physicality, thought and emotion, all these aspects.
Right. Yeah, exactly.
We can't escape from. Yeah.
So,
yeah, it's a
well, what do you think? I think we should wrap it up here.
Yeah, man, that was cool. Thank you.
Well, enjoyed that for coming on. You know, and it's always an honor to correspond with you and talk and go through these, you know, these kind of free, you know, freelance or free for all segments. You know, I like these where we're just flowing, you know, flowing with the energies. And working with it. I love that type of, you know, a type of energy, you know, that it produces and that it yields. It's very off the cuff, very unpredictable, very much in flow. So anyway, thanks for
coming. What do we got right now? The Uranian sun and moon square Uranus right now? I think that's going on.
Yeah, right. I mean, you know, I've got Uranus transiting my sun right now, you know, so
it's an amplifier. Yeah.
So, you know, freedom, right? I mean, I felt the most, some of the most freedom I felt in a long time for like in this lifetime. Wow. Yeah.
Yeah.
So I'm really catching.
Yeah. It's been an honor. Yeah.
Catching
thank you,
Uranus wave right now with my soul, my sun, you know, my will force. So it's been really good. I'm not saying it hasn't been a hard transit to deal with, you know, but again, like I said, your solar spiral is going to play out context to your aspects. And I just happen to have an aspect with the opposition with Saturn and Uranus. So, you know, so that, you know, that's been playing out with this transit, you know, and I've done Saturn. It's time for me to have and it's time for freedom now, you know.
So, yeah, breaking out of that.
Yeah, exactly. So I'm really enjoying that.
Excellent.
Making choices to my freedom more than anything else at this point. So
cool, man. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, it's been an honor and a pleasure to chat to you, on these wonderful tangents.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And hopefully we'll do it again. And everyone out there,
for sure.
You know, just keep going, keep forging, keep pushing, keep climbing the mountain. Take breaks, nurture yourself, you know, take care of yourself, take care of your physical body, take care of your mental state, you know, bring time, you know, to ritual, bring time to, you know, routine, nothing wrong with routine, and making, you know, making routine to meditation and drawing the circle of magician and clearing out your field and saging yourself, doing these practices, you know, they all
ritual of self-care.
Exactly. They all have purpose. Grounding yourself, you know, eating correctly, putting the right alchemical process and nutrients in your body, you know, taking care of your temple. It's the only one you've got. So with that, anything you'd like to say on the way out?
Yeah, same message as you. Keep going. We're doing really well. And yeah, just keep forging forth. And yeah. I love everyone and hope they're doing well and want to see the best for all of us. And I want to see actual, you know, bio-spiritual regenesis here on this planet, you know, like physical ascension, not this ascension in some other realm. This I'm going off to Pilates or whatever ascension, but actual physical ascension here with our physical body.
Yeah, the old 5D ascension. We're ascending to 5D.
Yeah. Now we'll go way past 5D, man. Yeah, right. We're going to go up to 15, 16, you know, we'll go further, you know, multidimensional ascension in the physical with this vessel we have and prime this prima materia that we have been given. And I think we can all do it. There's so much confirmation, so much to say that this is possible now in this cycle. So
absolutely.
Just a reminder of that, I guess. Yeah.
Okay, everyone, have an awesome year. This is your year of harvest. Claim it, make it happen, you know, and realize that, you know, your hard work is going to pay off. So don't get discouraged, all right? Okay, much love, everybody. And Blue Pericle is out. Your dream. Hey, hold on.
slowed down, hearted and misunderstood. Just over and over and over you could. Oh. Accouché, quoi, à ton lèvre. Accouché-toi à ton rêve. Quand tu vois ton bateau partir, quand tu sens ton cœur s'est brisé, accouché-toi à ton rêve. When you get so down that you can't get up, when you want so much but you're all out of luck, when you slow down.